So thank you all. Phyllis very nicely talked to you a little bit about some of the studies that were part of the original 14 grants that had to do mostly with the causal factors. And that research is incredibly important, but I would say that for many decades now, we've been documenting the causal factors and the gender inequities. And it's still important to do that. It's important to know that in 2018, we still have those, as we did 25 and 30 years ago when research in this area was getting started. I want to plug for, we really need to change our emphasis, at least in the research world, from documenting the causal factors to looking at interventions. And out of the 14 grantees, there were only 4 studies that were looking at interventions. And so I'm going to tell you a little bit about those, and then I'd love to hear if there's other kinds of interventions that you know about, have read about, because this really has to be where we focus. It can't be business as usual and more documenting of the causal factors, which I think we really have come to agree on, right? Unconscious bias, differences in mentoring and sponsorship, and on and on. We've talked about them a lot. So when we looked at Penn, I mean, we were fortunate enough to be one of the grantees who did an intervention trial. And actually, I have some of my colleagues here, J.A. Grizzo, Lucy Tuton. It was a multidisciplinary group that we put together. And as we were thinking about what we wanted to do in our intervention trial, we had this concept that trying to change the culture was about working from the top down and the bottom up. And when you think about that, the top down actually is maybe the more challenging in the grand scheme. I mean, this is what we have to do when we engage leaders at the highest level, the deans, the department chairs, the division chiefs, because without that clear commitment at the top, you really can't do institutional change. With policies and procedures that encourage flexibility. This is about the promotion requirements, tenure requirements, timelines, faculty positions, part-time positions, schedules, and encouraging flexibility as much as is possible. Family-friendly policies. Working on unconscious bias, which is, you know, ubiquitous and difficult to get at, but people are trying to do that. I'm going to tell you a minute about one of the studies that's looking at that. But really, that impact on search committees, of course, is critical. Salary equity, mentoring and sponsorship, administrative support, and holding division chiefs, department chairs accountable. This is the top down. Bottom up are the efforts that, again, important, and I don't want you to walk away with, these are important. It's what we're doing here. It's bringing women together, skill building, leadership programs, negotiation, team management, etc., peer and group mentoring, forming a community so that we have a voice, so that we can impact the leadership to create top-down change at the institutional level. But frankly, the bottom up are easier because we can bring ourselves together. We can do skill building. But what about the top down? And we just need more efforts there. And frankly, we need more grant money. And we were so excited when the NIH offered these R01s in 2008-09. This was the first time the NIH had ever put millions of dollars, literally, to look at this issue. And they have not done it a second time, by the way, with the difficulties with the budget. But the research partnership, under Phyllis's and others' leadership, works to try to convince them to do this again. And I would vote have all those grants be about interventions. So what we did at Penn, and I'm just going to do this really quickly because, you know, there's a lot to cover here, and I want to hear your thoughts. What we did at Penn is we created an intervention that went on over 3 years. And what we did is we took 27 departments across the Penn Medical School, and we randomized them. It's a cluster randomized trial, 13 in the intervention, 14 in the control group, and all of the assistant professors in those were randomized into, do I have a pointer here? I probably do, right? Do I have a pointer? All right, anyway, randomize them into the intervention and the control group, and you can see with the red circle, the intervention group over 3 years went through a multi-leveled intervention where we tried to work from the top down, as I described, and the bottom up. The top down, we met with the leaders, the department chairs, the deans, and the vice deans, and they were very much on board. I think, frankly, many of them were relieved that someone was at least coming up with an experiment to do. We worked at the level, what we call the intermediate level, the level of the departments, where can that there's a whole culture that goes on, as you all know, at the level of your departments, and that can differ very much from one department to another. And then we worked from the bottom up with the assistant professor women in the intervention group who went through two primary interventions. One of them was called a manuscript writing group, for which we put together the women. We paired them up with two senior women who developed an 8-session curriculum. And over the course of the 6 months, they went through basically this manuscript writing course, which again, I can't go into the details for the time, but it covered a lot of the things that are often not talked about. What do you do if you have writer's block? What if you've had two rejections and you want to throw it in the trash, but you actually should revise it and get it in the third time? Those kinds of things. And then the second intervention that they went through was called Total Leadership. A guy named Stu Friedman collaborated with us from Wharton, who has a really fascinating Total Leadership course that he's given all over the world, actually. But to simplify it, it's about clarifying your goals, what's important to you not only in your work life, but in your private life, for you as an individual, in terms of your health and well-being, and for you as a member of a community. And what he does is he has you meet with stakeholders and then put together experiments that try to capitalize on integrating those different spheres. So simplified down, it's kind of a work-life balance course that through experimentation and work with a peer group, you get to think a lot about what's important to you and how you might be able to get the goals in all the spheres of your life accomplished. So those were the two interventions that we did on the level of the assistant professors. So this goes on, and 3 years pass. And the control group, nothing is going on. And then at the end, we have our outcomes. And as you can see, it's a culture measure that we developed and work-family conflict measures that we had. I have to get my glasses on here. Self-efficacy measure and looking at work hours. And so what about our outcomes? And again, I could talk a whole hour about this. Fortunately for you, I'm not going to. What's the summary of it? So we found out, no surprise, but it's really nice to document it because data speaks, and data often speaks to the leaders that we're trying to influence, that culture really matters. We developed a tool that was validated that we could really show that culture differs a lot, for example, in neurosurgery than it is in emergency medicine. We also showed that culture is important enough that when you actually look at work hours, and you know that in medicine in general and in academics, work hours are frequently around 60 hours a week or so for many people, and that if you were in a department that had a good culture, a supportive culture for women in that department, it actually mitigated the effect of the long work hours on work-family conflict. So culture can be measured, culture matters, and culture can mitigate some of the things, particularly with this work-family conflict, that are so important to women. We also found, a little bit disappointing, if I must be honest, that there was no difference in the intervention and the control group in terms of our measurement of academic productivity, publications and grants. However, publications and grants for both the intervention and the control group went up by 45% for peer-reviewed publications and grants by 50%. So this was amazing. And we're still can't be entirely sure what's going on. It could be that that was just going to increase no matter what, or it could be that despite the fact that we had a cluster randomized trial and tried to control for everything, we were unable to do that because it's a real world trial and we actually had an effect across the institution, which I think there's a good chance, of course I want to believe that, this was a very visible trial and we had the deans and the vice deans, and even Amy Gutman, the president of Penn, was on our advisory group. So it got a lot of visibility, and we would like to believe that we actually had an effect across the whole institution, and that's why there was such a benefit for both the control and the intervention group. We also found that the PhDs, as an isolated group, did actually increase their productivity more than in the control group. Not the MDs, but the PhDs. And so it may be that one of the take-homes is that you can't have an intervention across an entire medical school that includes, by the way, you know, clinical departments, basic science departments. I mean, this was across the medical school. So it might have just been too much of a sort of a broad strokes for everybody. Maybe, in fact, we need to think about interventions that are more targeted at the unique daily work habits, lifestyles, and needs of these individual groups, and that they're significantly different. We were really excited to find that our intervention faculty decreased their work hours while sustaining this increase in productivity that I just talked about. They shaved off about 4 hours of self-reported work hours a week. I can tell you that I'd love to have 4 hours back in a week. I don't know about you. You know, you could argue, is that enough? Does that make a difference? I don't know, but I do think that shaving off some of the hours that we all work while maintaining productivity and accomplishing the goals that we want in our careers is one way of looking at these interventions. And then we had task forces, which I haven't talked much about. But just briefly, remember I told you that our intervention worked at the levels of the leaders, worked at the levels of the assistant professor women, and then we had this intervention at the level of the departments that consisted of forming task forces. So we had 13 task forces, one in each of the 13 departments, that put together mid to senior career, both men and women, by the way, in the departments, and we made the charge this simple. Come up with an intervention in your department, do it for 2 years, devise your metrics, and tell us in 2 years what you've accomplished. We did not give them a cent, no money, just do this. Now, we did bring them together so that they were to share ideas. We had an outside facilitator who was hugely helpful in sort of, you know, you have to, I mean, you're asking people to add to their busy plate, now we want you to come up with an intervention in your department. But frankly, the take home from these task forces was that they were amazing. That actually, you bring faculty together and say, we want you to come up with something, I want you to try it for 2 years. They were very enthusiastic and came up with some really interesting things, which I'm gonna show, which I'm gonna show you here. No, I need to go back. So just tonight, remember we had 13 in the intervention group, so this is just to show you a few of them. There was an overhaul of the clinical accounting of night and weekend clinical call for junior and senior faculty in one of our departments. And this was huge because this was a department where the junior faculty were really feeling that they were being taken advantage of in terms of call. Increased support and accountability for mentoring programs. Creation of a vice chair of faculty development or faculty affairs. This had not been a typical vice chair department at Penn, and now virtually all the departments have this position. Home reading stations for the Department of Radiology. This was huge. This did cost money, by the way, but that was money that the department was willing to put in. It was actually hugely expensive, but has changed the face of call for the Department of Radiology faculty. They can now, nights, weekends, and holidays, do their reading from home in their pajamas, I hear. Startup packages to support mentors of junior faculty in the basic sciences, where the mentoring of junior faculty is even more extensive than what happens in clinical departments. So these were exciting. I mean, they had individual metrics. Was that part of the reason why they were able to shave off 4 hours of their work week because of efficiencies that were part of this? I can't answer that. But That's what we'd like to believe. So just in the last few minutes, because we don't have much, I'm going to just briefly tell you about the other three R01s that were part of the research partnership that looked at other interventions. So many of you, all of you probably have heard of these National Career Development Programs for women. The AAMC has an early career and a mid-career, and then there's ELAM, or the Executive Leadership in Academic Medicine, which is a year-long fellowship. And this group wanted to look at whether or not they could document outcomes from these professional development programs for women. So they did a survey. There were 879 women who looked at 16 different skills and reported whether or not that they were had already had them, whether or not they were new after this experience. And they looked at them, and four skills predominated. Now, interpersonal leadership, negotiation, and networking skills turned out to be the ones that were sort of most documented from these experiences. And I think many of us, probably many of you here in the room, have been to these. These are also excellent, like things like what we're doing today. But it's hard to document the effect of these, and they cost money. Schools want to know if they're putting their money into a place that's giving them a bang for their buck. But these are soft outcomes, and what we really need is to come up with studies that show that they actually could translate these skills into advancing in their careers, leadership positions, salary equity, whatever. The second one was an intervention. I don't know how many of you know about the family-friendly programs and policies at UC Davis in California. They probably have the most progressive family-friendly policies in the nation. They've done a lot of work in this area. They have a 12-week maternity leave, paid leave, and a number of other very progressive family leave policies. And so this was an innovative accelerator intervention. And what that basically means is that for 2 years, they did an educational media blitz, because they had found that these wonderful policies that were the most progressive in the country weren't actually being used. They weren't being taken advantage of. So they went out and for 2 years just used every opportunity, media, print, grand rounds, workshops, going to departments and giving talks at faculty meetings. I mean, everything possible to try to let everybody know about this. And what they did find was that in surveys, again, self-reports, that there was an increased awareness, that there were improved attitudes about actually using these policies. And most pronounced for female faculty and faculty under 50, not really surprising. But this is soft data, and we need to think about how this then translates to the more important outcomes. Did they actually use the policies, and did that lead to advancement and longevity of careers for women? All right, in my last 2 minutes, real quick, Molly Carnes deserves more than the minute I'm going to give to her. She is amazing. She has led the work in unconscious bias. She has done so much work. This is what she did as one of the R01s. She got a gender bias habit changing intervention, which essentially was a 2.5-hour workshop that she gave to over 2,000 faculty at University of Wisconsin in Madison. And then she showed that, in fact, she did increase self-efficacy for the faculty who were part of this intervention. That's a soft finding. The harder finding, which came in a study afterwards, that there was an increase in women hired by the intervention departments by 18%. That's the kind of harder findings that we want to look for. But we need money and grant money to do that. So, interventions. Let's switch it. We don't need any more. We do need to continue to document, but we need to do the harder work of interventions. And again, we need to influence the leaders, because it's influencing the leaders that's going to allow us to experiment with some of these top-down, policy-driven, practice-driven interventions that I think are key to the next step. So big picture strategy, my last slide, must be framed as a waste of talent. Must move to institutional change, not change the women. Engage the highest levels of leadership and work on both large and small, whatever you can do, maybe just in your division, change efforts and study them. Thank you.